like to begin this morning by thanking everyone, whether you came early to help in the kitchen and get things set up, or whether you were just here to participate in yesterday morning's worship, Stewardship the Jesus Way, which was presented by Reverend Patrick Rogers of the United Church of Christ down in Fort Lauderdale. Now, although the workshop title was not very sexy in its title, the presentation of the material by Reverend Rogers was absolutely right on with reinforcing all that has been going on through our Crossroads experience. The one basic message that I personally took from yesterday's workshop was, we are stewards. We are stewards of God's message. How we choose to conduct ourselves as a church will directly affect the ministry and the success of this church. How we choose to be stewards of God's message will affect the ministry of this church. Last Sunday, as we have been this morning, we are challenged to invite someone to come and visit our church on the second Sunday of February. This action in itself, this invitation of inviting somebody to come and join us, as we learned yesterday, is one of those acts of stewardship. Have you ever thought about that before? Today, our scripture continues the story of Jesus calling his disciples. As a child, I saw this text as this great story of how Jesus started collecting his ministerial team and to do his ministry. Then in my 20s, as I started, after I finished college, started in the workforce, I began to wonder, why would people who had a life just drop everything and start following this man called Jesus? Then somewhere in my adult life, and I'm not going to tell you how much of an adult I have become, Paul, my gosh, I challenge the fact that I'm even an adult yet. But somewhere in my adult life, I have started to see the story as talking about how one invests their life. And you know what? This has actually been our deeper question throughout the Crossroads discussions. It is a discussion of investing our lives, a question of stewardship of God's resources. You, me, this building, our money, our time, our interests, these are all resources that God has already provided here for his ministry. Now, I love John telling here in this gospel that Beverly just read about Nathanael's response to Philip's invitation to come and meet Jesus. Philip went and he found Nathanael and told him, we have found the one that Moses has been talking about and the one that all the prophets have spoken of. And do you know who it is?
Who on earth could that be?
It is Jesus, the son of Joseph. You know, the one from Nazareth. And Nathanael responded, Nazareth? You've got to be kidding. But Philip said, come, see for yourself. In my early 20s, my then mother-in-law presented me with a copy of this novel, In His Steps. I don't know if any of you have ever had the opportunity to read this book. It has been around for more than 120 years.
Wow.
And has sold over 30 million copies. And as providence turns out, it was written by Charles Sheldon, who happened to be a Congregationalist minister. Isn't that odd? Because I was a Baptist at the time. in one of those changing events in my life. In its pages, I was challenged to look at my life, evaluate what I wanted out of my life, and what did it mean for me to be a follower of Christ. In the safety of those pages, I was able to visualize the joys as well as the hurts and actually sometimes the danger and harm that comes along when one takes seriously the investing of one's life in the ways and teachings of Jesus. For you see, it's been my observation that most of us are really afraid of the power God can have in our lives when we choose to invest in God's teachings.
Amen.
We read in the book of Acts how the church grew in leaps and bounds in its first few centuries. The power of investing their lives in Jesus was so strong in the early church that it drew thousands upon thousands of people around the Mediterranean to the lifestyle that has grown, that has spread throughout the world, and has lasted for over 2,000 years. Why is it then that in North American churches, we are wringing our hands and complaining about shrinking numbers? The answer, I believe, is found in the pages that Reverend Sheldon wrote about in his novel, that the church has lost the belief in the power of living in Christ. The church today has lost a belief of the power that comes with living in Christ. Oh, we give a lip service, all right. But when given the opportunity to be good stewards of God's gifts, of turning the other cheek, of offering our tunic when somebody has already stolen our cloak, of sharing what we possess with those who lack, of living in forgiveness, of passing on our change to someone who's at the street corner, how well do we fare? That is the question and challenge that not only the Bible talks about, but that Sheldon put in this book. So I would encourage you to go to your library. I hope a library still has this in print. If not, I've got it in mine. I'm more than happy to read it. It's great reading. But that's the question that Sheldon dealt with in his book, In His Steps. One of Sheldon's characters explains the change in her life after taking on the challenge of asking, what would Jesus do? Do you ever wonder where that phrase came from over the last 30, 40 years? Sheldon coined it 120 years ago. Ask yourself, before you do anything, what would Jesus do? She says, this character, I used to think that to be a Christian, I had to live my life by keeping Jesus' commands. Now, I just let Jesus live in my heart. This character was able to do this because she started to invest her life in Jesus instead of living what she thought that Jesus would want her to do. Understand the difference? So let me personalize it this way. When Steve Mitchell stopped living his life the way that he thought others expected him to live and started living it a life that was true to who he was, he started the transformation of becoming a whole person. I was no longer fearful of who I was. But most of all, I found peace that I had never experienced before. And that peace came through the internal sense that God loved me for who I am. I started understanding that phrase, no matter who you are or where you are in life's journey, you are welcome here. The here is in God's presence. Jesus says, no greater gift is this than the gift of love. Love is not passive, it is active. Love means giving up the power that comes through oppression. Love means standing side by side with those who were most in need. Love means seeing that the basic needs like food, shelter, health care, companionship are all available to those who are powerless to provide for themselves. David Cunningham, professor of religion at Hope College in Holland, Michigan, writes, "The love that structures the inner life of God gives us a sense of the proper pattern for Christian love. Far from a mere feeling of euphoria, it is a disciplined habit of care and concern that, like all the virtues, can be perfected only over a lifetime." As a congregation, we will never fully abide in God because it is a lifetime process. As individuals who say we follow Christ and his teachings, we will never completely achieve a fullness of abiding in God because it is what that journey is about. The abiding in, the investment of our life in God. But if we start to ask ourselves, I wonder what Jesus would do in this instance. And if the answer has the action of love in it, then we will not go very wrong. For no greater love does one have for their friends than to lay down their life. Those are powerful words. Jesus went to the cross for his friends. For us, for the world, let us do the same by investing our lives.